Hello everyone and welcome to 8086 microprocessor lecture. In this lecture, we will discuss architecture of 8086 microprocessor.
We have seen the different evaluations of microprocessor. We have started with 8080. Then how the different extra features have been added into microprocessor. For example, the data bus has been increased. Address bus has been increased, then pipelining concept was introduced, cache memories were introduced. All these extra superscalar technologies have been used to increase the performance in terms of speed and capability of any microprocessor. Now today let's see architecture of 8086 microprocessor. Different features of 8086 microprocessor are, basically it is a 16-bit microprocessor. As you know, it is launched by Intel in 1978. This microprocessor is actually a 14-pin IC. Its data bus size is 16-bit. Its address bus size is 20 bits. You know that when we say address bus is 20 bits, what is memory that can be accessed? It is equal to 2 raised to 20, that means 1 main. So internal memory of this 8086 is 1 main. Then all internal registers are of 16 bits. Last time we have seen that whatever data bus size we have, 16 bit here, same internal data bus size will be there. Then first design 8086 microprocessor was using clock frequency 8 MHz. This is pin diagram of 8086 microprocessor. As I said, it is a 14-pin IC and it has got 16-bit data bus and 20-bit address bus. You can see here the highlighted one, AD0, starting from this AD0 up to this 39-pin AD15. It is written AD. The feature of 8086 microprocessor is that data bus and address bus, they are multiplexed. What is meaning of multiplexing of this data and address bus? Whenever CPU want to send address, the same lines starting from this AD0 up to AD15, they are used for address transfer. Whenever data is to be sent, then same buses are used as data buses. We have seen that there are three types of buses. One is data bus, one is address bus, and one is control bus. Here, address bus and data bus up to AD0, up to AD15, that means total 16 bits, they are common. They are sometimes used as address bus, sometimes they are used as data bus. Then the remaining, and therefore actually you can see here A and D is written. Then remaining 4 bits, AD16 to AD19, they are pin number from 35 to 38. These are purely used as your address bus because data bus is only of 16 bits. But address bus is of 20 bits, 4 more bits are, 4 more terminals are required, as you can see. And therefore, these are purely used as your address buses. Along with, they have been assigned some different function as strobes. Then other this, these functions, they are basically control functions useful for your minimum and maximum mode of operation of 8086, that we'll see later on. Whatever we have seen up till now, you can see here there is one pin called as INTA bar, which we have already studied. What is INTA bar? It's interrupt acknowledgement and this is interrupt request. We are seeing that IO devices, they are communicating with CPU by first of all generating the signal called as INTR, interrupt request. So this IO device will generate this INTR signal to 8086. 8086 will perform its current execution. After completion of that execution, it will generate back INTA bar signal, giving green signal for IO device to transfer the data. Okay? And this is your NMR. non-maskable interrupt, which is highest priority interrupt signal. Okay, all other contour pins we'll see as we move ahead. Then let's see detailed architecture of 8086. 8086 is basically using your pipelining concept. Yesterday we have seen what is concept of pipelining. Any instruction is executed basically in three steps. One is fetch, that means instruction is taken inside. Then it is decoded, that means its meaning is interpreted, whether that instruction is for addition, whether that instruction is for subtraction, whether it is comparison. So that instruction is decoded, and once decoding step is done, then final step is execution. So any instruction for 8086 is carried out in three steps: fetching, decoding and execution. For this three steps implementation, basically your 8086 architecture has been divided into two parts. One is called bus interface unit and second one is called execution unit. Each part has got its specific application or specific functions. In case of BIU, you have to access the data or instruction from memory or IO devices. So basically taking inside any data or going out data is a major task of our BIU section. And execution unit basically does decoding and execution. So BIU unit basically does fetching cycle, and in case of decoding and execution, second execution unit plays important role. So this is architecture. As I said, there are two units. One is BIU unit and one is EQ unit. Okay? Basically, here this is BIU unit. You can see here basically there are memory devices or your IO devices connected. In case of BIU unit, you can see there are different registers. Basically, these are your registers. Here, memory or IO devices are connected. The instruction or data is taken in from this part inside your CPU by this BIU unit. Here you can see the word written Q. Q is for your concept of pipelining. If you measure this, how many Q bits are there? There are total 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So in case of 8086, basically 6 instructions can be taken inside. Got it? And this Q works on first in, first out. That means whenever first instruction comes inside this queue, it resides here. That instruction will be taken in by execution unit for decoding and execution state. At the same time, all the instructions, or you can say maximum 6 instructions, can come and reside inside queue. Okay? So basically this queue structure speed up your execution of program. Once this queue has got some instructions, they are given to your execution unit. This execution unit consists of your control unit, ALU, and there are some general purpose registers. We have already seen register structure architecture. So this control unit basically decodes the instruction and generates the required control signals. The control signals, depending upon control signals, the data will be given to ALU. We have seen that basically ALU performs all types of arithmetic and logical operations. All kind of programs basically require this ALU operations. This is structure of your BIU, only BIU section, in which we can see that there are four basically things. One is your bus interface logic. Because buses are common, in case of 8086, we have seen that your AD0 to AD15, for 16 buses, they are multiplex. So So whether they are used as data buses or whether they are acting as address buses, that signal, proper signals have to be generated. So bus interface logic is must. Then we have segment register, the blue one CS, PS, ES, SS and IP. These are your segment registers. What are its purpose? We will come to this later on. Then memory addressing logic is required, because whenever you want to generate some signals for memory, you have to tell memory from which memory location data is to be read or where data has to be written. That address needs to be generated, isn't it? That we have already seen. So memory addressing logic is must, and then we must have 6 byte instruction object code queue. So this is about your segments. Basically, there are 4 segments registers which we have seen in previous slide. Here, in general, memory of 8086 is shown. We have seen that what is address bus width of 8086? What is it? 20 bits, right? So, in case of 20 bits, what is memory that can be accessed? 1 meg, right? So, this 1 meg memory is physically available. This 1 meg memory is logically divided into 4 segments. 1 meg is physically available, and this logically it is divided into 4 segments: core segment, data segment, XOR segment and stack segment. The bifurcation or division is done for simplicity of execution. It reduces complexity because each and every segment has got particular application. When it is say that core segment, what it could be? Yes, when I say core segment, what it could be? It is going to store what? My codes or my instructions, right? When I say data segment, it is purely meant for my data storage. XOR segment, basically XOR segment is supporting my data segment, it also stores data. Then stack segment, we already seen memory stack organization. Yeah. So, in case of stack segment, only the variables, or basically that stack segment is purely used as your stack. Okay. Here, you can see that each segment is divided into 4 logical parts, and each segment has got capacity of 64 KB. Fine. Now when I say that this is one segment, I am going to insert some programs, instruction into this code segment, isn't it? It's not always necessary that all 64 KBs will be used. Depending upon my instruction length, some part will be utilized, some part will remain empty. So I must have some pointer or some method by which I will be knowing that up from 64 KB this much has been filled. Even in case of stack, we have seen that I am going to insert data inside stack using push instruction. So how many stack is filled and how much is empty or available for next operation, that must be known. So we have all these segment registers. Here we have seen that these are segment registers. These are only 16-bit registers, right? And here, these are your segment memories. If I have filled up to this, then it is my core segment register is going to point over here. How much is filled? On the top of that, each segment register will store that particular value. Since I have 4 segments, I will be needing 4 segment register values: core segment register, data segment register, extra segment register and stack segment register. So the names given CS is your core segment register, then DS is data segment register, ES is extra segment register, SS is stack segment register. Got it? So this is your 4 segment registers of BIU section. What is width of these register? Each register is of 16 bit, because data bus size of 8086 is 16 bit. Fine. instruction, position of your instruction. Okay, so instruction pointer basically points to the instruction to be executed. The track of execution or the one which is to be fetched next, that memory is or that particular address is kept by instruction pointer. So this is about your BIU section, segment registers. This is about your instruction pointer. It is a 16-bit register holding the 16-bit address or offset of the next 4 byte within the code segment. The instruction pointer, this is important in this, the instruction pointer is incremented after each opcode fetch, because it has to point to next instruction. So once your fetch cycle or fetch step has been completed, automatically instruction pointer is incremented by 1. Then we have instruction queue. I already said that to speed up program execution, the BIU fetches as many as 6 instruction bytes. This queue length varies from microprocessor to microprocessor. For 8086 it is 6 bytes, for 8088 it is 4 bytes. So 6 instruction bytes ahead of time from memory. The free fetch instruction bytes are created for the execution unit in a first in first out group of register called a queue. After execution of current instruction, the EU simply reads the instruction from the queue in the BIU. Fetching the next instruction while the current instruction executes is called pipelining. Now let's come to execution unit. In case of execution unit, as I said, 2 steps are carried out basically by execution unit. Fetching is already done by BIU. Already my instructions are fetched and they are lying in my queue. Now from queue, 1 instruction will be taken inside by control unit of my execution unit. This control unit will decode the instruction, that means it will try to interpret what CPU is supposed to do. Depending upon the state, it will generate control signals and the instruction will be passed on for ALU for execution. We have seen ALU structure in which there are 2 entries, 2 data variables are required for ALU. That general purpose register structure, if you remember, we have seen that there are 2 multiplexers and we have n number of registers. From each register, 1 data comes to ALU and from another register, another data comes inside ALU. ALU performs some operation. We have seen 14-bit word, how it has been set, right? So 14-bit word, depending upon that 14-bit word, ALU performs the operation and it generates some result. The result is again stored back in your general purpose registers. As well as it generates some outputs for flag register. Flag register and all these registers, they all are 16-bit wide. Okay? Let's see flag register in detail later on. I think this is clear. Blocks of the execution units are data and address registers. These are your data and address registers, your ALU control unit, and functions of your execution unit are decodes, generation and execution. ALU, as you know, it performs arithmetic as well as logical operations. Addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and your logical operation, not AND or exclusive OR. This middle part is important. Arithmetic operations are performed on 4 types of whole numbers. When you are writing any program, you have to declare the variables. The 4 types of number which can be processed by ALU are unsigned binary numbers, or it can be signed binary numbers, then unsigned packed decimal numbers, unsigned unpacked decimal numbers. You have solved some problems on packing and unpacking, right? Okay? So these 4 types can be processed by ALU of 8086. Now coming to your general registers, these general registers. How many general registers you can see? One is AX, BX, CX, DX, SI, DI, BP and SP. SI is source index, DI is destination index, BP is base pointer, SP is stack pointer. Your AX, BX, CX and DX, these are general purpose register used to store some data or used for current execution of your ALU. Each and every register has got specific meaning and specific function has been allocated to each by default. In using program you can change it. So basically the CPU has 8 16-bit general registers. They are divided into two types. One is your data register and second one the pointer and index registers. Data registers mainly used for arithmetic and logic operations. Even your the pointer and index register, they are basically used to hold the offset value. Why this offset value hold is required, that we will see later on, because all the buses are of 16 bits, all the register are of 16 bits, but what is memory location that has to be accessed? It is of 20 bits, right? So CPU basically generates 16 bit output while it has to generate the address of 20 bits for memory location access. So for conversion of this 16 bit to 20 bits, we require some offset values. And for these offset values, many pointer and index registers are required. Then other than that, the pointer registers are used to access the current stack segment. The index registers are used to access the current data. However, they can also be used in most arithmetic and logical operations if mentioned in your program. This is the registers which I have already talked about, but you can see one thing. As I said, each register is of 16 bits, right? AX, BX, CX and DX. These registers you can see here, they are divided into two parts, each of 8 bits. AX, it is accumulator, but it is divided into two. One is called accumulator lower bits. And another or uppermost 8 bits, they are called accumulator higher bits, AH. Either I can use AL or I can use AH. And if I want 16 bits data to be transferred, then directly I can use AX. So facility has been given that I can either use only 8 bits or I can use 16 bits. Got it? Same with BX, same with CX, same with DX. Each one is divided into lower 8 bits and higher 8 bits. This is called accumulator, this is called base register, this is called count register, this is called data register. This pointer registers and index register, they are purely of 16 bits, they cannot be divided into two parts, because their function is totally different. This is for stack pointer, this is base pointer, source index and destination index. As I said, each and every register has been assigned some specific function. Here you can see AX is your 16-bit accumulator. It stores the 16-bit results of arithmetic and logic operations. By default, every result is stored in accumulator. AL or AH is 8-bit accumulator. It stores the 8-bit results of arithmetic and logic operation if your result is generated as 8 bits. Then BX is my base register. It used to hold base value in base addressing mode to access my memory data. CX is count register. it used to hold the count value when you are performing the logical operations, when you are shifting the data, rotating right shift or left shift, or in case of loop instruction, you have to keep counts. So for that count keeping, you have to load that count value in your CX register. Then you have DX or data register. It is used to hold the data for multiplication and division operation. Directly in 8086, division and multiplication instructions have been given. So whenever you are doing multiplication and division, then your DX register is used. Then we have stack pointer. It used to hold the offset address of top stack memory. Then we have base pointer. Used to hold the base value and base address in using SS register to access data from stack memory. Then we have source index. Used to hold index value of source operand for string instruction, and data index used to hold the index value of destination operand for string operation. So basically, whenever you are performing some string operation, your SI and DI are very useful. Along with that, sometimes for string operation, CX and DX registers are also used. Now, as I said, one more register is very important, that is called as flag register. Along with all these registers, whenever ALU performs any arithmetic or logical operation, it is going to generate some result. The data value of that result will be stored in one of the registers. But depending upon its operation, it also generates some control signals. The control signals, they are, you can say, stored in your flag register. The flag register, as you can see, it's a 16-bit register. Its 0th value, or 0th bit is for CF, it's carry flag. Then first one is not used, second one is called parity flag, third one not used, AF auxiliary, zero flag, sign flag, trap flag, interrupt flag, data flag and offset, overflow flag. Then 12, 13, 14, 15 bits are not used. These bits are specific. Let's see first of all function and then I will tell you why these flag registers are so important. As I said, first 0th bit is for carry flag. Carry flag is set when there is a carry out of MSB in case of addition or borrow in case of subtraction. That means whenever you are performing some addition operation, the result is it produces some sum and it produces carry. If carry is generated, then your carry flag is set. This is the indication that if I am going to perform say 4 bit plus 4 bit addition, my result generated is 5 bits. That 5th bit is nothing but my, if that 5th bit is going to set my carry flag equal to 1. Okay? Then next is my parity. You know how we define parity? Parity is how many number of ones. This parity flag is very important. This flag is set to 1 if the lower byte of the result contains even number of ones. And for odd number, it is set to 0. So it is automatically going to count after the result how many number of ones are present. If that number of ones is equal to even number, then this parity flag is set. In many operations or whenever you are doing interfacing, this parity flag is very important. Then your third flag is auxiliary carry. In case of auxiliary carry, basically, if you remember when you are carrying out your 8-bit addition, how you do addition? 8-bit addition you do, right? You have studied nibble addition as well. After first 4-bit addition, if some carry is generated and carried over to 5th column, then that particular thing is called auxiliary carry. So auxiliary carry is basically a carry generated for nibble. Nibble is your 4 bits. So after 4 bit addition, if something is carried for 5th bit, then your auxiliary carry flag is set. Then you have 0 flag. This flag is set if the result of the computation or comparison performed by instruction is 0. You can visualize why this 0 flag is so important. If my comparison, or when I am doing some subtraction, if that subtraction output is 0, then this particular flag is going to be set. Where I can use this function of 0 flag equal to 0, equal to 1? Whenever I am doing looping, if I have some counter type of thing, then I can say if this particular thing is equal to 0, or when I am comparing to A equal to B, then do this. If A is greater than B, then do this. If A less than B, then do this. For that particular thing, all this 0 flag, carry flag and sign flag, they are important. When I say that 0 flag is set, means that A is equal to B. So just by checking 0 flag, I can conclude if A is equal to B or not. When I am doing say A minus B greater than 0, in that case, A minus B is greater than 0, that means I should get some positive result. After this, there is sign flag. See, sign flag is going to set if my operation or output is negative. If A minus B is greater than 0, if I say that if A minus B is greater than 0, do this. And if I get sign flag equal to 0, then indication is that my result is positive. That means A minus B is greater than 0. Right? If I get sign flag equal to set, in that case, what is the conclusion? A minus B is got some negative answer. That means what? A is less than B. Okay? So A minus B is less than 0. Then what you have to do? That you have to declare in your program. So whenever these branching or decision blocks have to be implemented, then these flag registers are very important. Next is your trap flag. If this flag is set, the processor enters the single step execution mode by generating internal interrupts after the execution of each instruction. Whenever you are doing decoding or debugging, the facility is available that instead of execution of full program running, you can execute it one step by one step, so that debugging becomes easier. For that, you have to set your trap flag equal to 1. Next is your interrupt flag. It causes the 8086 to recognize external masked interrupts. Clearing IF disables these interrupts. That means whenever I am doing some important execution, I don't want any interrupt. I don't want any IO device to interfere. In that case, I will just set or I will just disable this interrupt flag. In that case, any IO device, if he or she want, if that device wants to communicate, then that will not be entertained. Okay? Next is your direction flag. This is used for string manipulation instruction. If this flag bit is 0, the string is processed beginning from the lowest address to the highest address. Whenever you are doing string operation, I should mention that string operation has to be performed in this direction or in this direction, from lower to higher or from higher to lower, from left side or from right side. Okay? So during that string operation, I have to mention in which direction I should follow, that is set by my direction flag. And last flag is overflow flag. This flag is set if an overflow occurs. When overflow is going to occur, if the result of sign operation is large enough to accommodate in destination register. That means you have generated some result. If that result is greater than your 16-bit destination register, in that case, this overflow flag is it's in set condition, meaning that the reserve produce cannot be treated in the T1 16 bit register. Okay, then you have to do some extra arrangements. The result is of more than 7 bits in size in case of 8 bits side operation, and more than 15 bits in size in case of 16 bit side operation, then the overflow will be set. Can anybody tell me? Here it is written that if the result is more than 7 bits in case of 8 bit operation, I am doing 8 bit operation, so what is expected result? It has to be 8 bit, isn't it? Then why it is comparing only 7 bits? Because we have seen that arithmetic and logical unit ALU also performs on sign bit. Last year you have studied how to represent sign numbers in binary. You are always MSB is used for declaration of your whether the number is positive or negative. So always your MSB is reserved as sign bit, and therefore here it is written that only 7 bits result will be compared. Okay, so that is your overflow register. Then any doubt up till now? This is about architecture of 8086.